Distance Knitting Podcast. This is episode 28, and just had a weird message pop up on my screen. This is my second time recording this today. The first one, once it was all finished and I looked at it, I really didn't like it, and I realized there was a lot of things I left out, even though it was 42 minutes long. So there was a lot of rambling too. So as a result, I'm re-recording it, so hopefully I will be a little more happy with it, because I like to have the best I can put out there for you guys to look at. I do appreciate y'all coming back each week to watch. If you're a new viewer, I hope you enjoy the video. Click the little red button down there, the subscribe button. And if you're a returning viewer, thank you for stopping by, and feel free to leave a comment or give me a thumbs up. So let's get started, and I will show you what I've gotten done this week. I do have a sort of finished object, and I'll explain that one in a minute. If you remember, this sweater was in my tub of shame, and last week I had ripped the sleeves off, and I was starting to put them back on. I had one done. I was working on the other one. Ta-da! They're both done. They are both finished. These are drop sleeves, so if they look a little small, it's because they actually hit just below my elbow. So they are dropped sleeves, and oops, there's an ending. I did not get tucked in. I have to say a special thank you to Karen of SSK Yarners. She saw I was doing Magic Loop, and these were the needles I was using. This is surgical tubing. It does not do Magic Loop very easily. I mean, it works, but as you can see, it's pretty stiff. It's not something that's real conducive to Magic Loop. And she told me that she used 9-inch sock needles to do her sleeves. And I was like, oh, I gotta go do that. So I even told her, I said, I see a visit to my yarn shop in the very near future, which I did that very Tuesday night. I went to the yarn shop. Ta-da! These are actually, I think these are 12-inch. I have fatter arms than 9-inch. These are 12-inch, and it made it go so much faster than having to move everything around. It was so much quicker. So not only did I buy the 9-inch, but I also bought 16-inch. That one is, the one that I just put down is in a size 4, I believe, U.S. size 4. This is a U.S. 5. And I have a whole bunch of worsted weight wool that I'm going to be eventually making into sweaters, because it's kind of coarse wool, and so it is going to get in like cardigans, that type of thing. Yes, thank you, Karen, for that tip. That saved me like mega hours trying to fool with the Magic Loop. So yes, this is the way to go from here on out. So I bought those two needles. I also have a major needle haul, which I'll show you later on in the podcast. But when I say that this is only partially finished, I finished the sleeves, but this is all the yarn I had left, because the sleeves I put back on were, of course, narrower. Remember, they had built-in bat wings for my fat arms. So these did not. So I saved a lot of yarn. So I decided, since this sweater was a relatively short sweater, I mean, it went to my waist, but I like a little bit longer. I believe I've got enough yarn to put a few more rows in. So I actually ripped off the ribbing from the bottom, and I'm going to attach the yarn that I showed you. Now, the interesting thing with this is when I knitted this, I did not use a pattern or anything, but I knit sweaters from the bottom up. So the ribbing was the first thing I knitted. So when I tried to rip it off, of course, you couldn't just zip the stitches out like you could if I had ripped it out from the top. So they actually had to be individually picked. So it took me a couple hours this morning just picking the ribbing off. So from here down, however long I get, this part is going this direction. The stitches from here down are going to go this way. But I've tried this before, and in all honesty, you can't tell the difference unless you're really, really looking close that the stitches go two different directions. It's really not that noticeable. So, and I know other people have done that too. They've spliced sleeves in and things like that, and it doesn't show all that much. So that is what I'm going to be doing this week, is adding a little length to that. Then let me show you my Find Your Fade. I got all the way through. I'm just about done all of the Sunseeker at this point. Here is where I was last week. I was just melting into the last Sunseeker color. I've gone all the way through the lace, and now I'm into the first row of where it begins to melt back into the next color, which would be color number 6. This is all I have left of the Sunseeker. So maybe a row or two more left. And this is the color that is melting into next. And melting is basically striping. And then eventually you run out of the stripes and it goes to the solid color. So that's what I'm at now. It's kind of a cornflower blue in case it's not turning up well. So I've been working on that. I have added a few more squares to my Cozy Memories blanket. The only reason, because I only have added like 3 or 4 squares, but I did want to show you because some of them that I've added were ones that I dyed. So last week I showed you this one and this one that I had dyed. So the blue one and the red one here. And then this week I put this one on. And this one, this was the speckled one that I did, and this was the yellow tonal that I did. So I've added, altogether I've added a row this week. This top row has all been added this week. So I now have 6, 4, 5, 6, 7. I have 35 squares total so far. So it's coming along, but it's as I get scraps, I add it into it. So it's a continuous work in progress. Now I will show you, I'm going to move away from knitting for just a minute. And I had showed you this blue dress. I have a purple one too. The purple one's actually working out so far. But this was the one I talked about last week that I said I was so frustrated, had a love-hate relationship with my sewing machine. It's very stretchy, t-shirty type material. And if you can see, I'm looking in the monitor to make sure you can tell what happened. Yeah, there you can see it. See how it bunched up? Because it's stretchy, I really am having a hard time with it. It looked okay at the top, but the hem is where I'm having a lot of the problems. I think what I'm going to do is I can pull it over just like this and just hand sew it, and I think I'll be okay. Just basically tack it, not stretch it as I'm sewing it. I talked to a coworker that sews. I talked to my daughter-in-law that makes quilts. And I also chatted back and forth with Kristen from Yarngasm, the podcast. She does wool and vine yarns, but she also sews. And so I got suggestions from all of them. And I followed through with those suggestions, but I think some of it is just my sewing machine's just not meant to do so stretchy material very well. So, yeah, I'm still working on it, but I think I'm hoping I can salvage the dress at this point. So, and talking about sewing, I've been watching a lot of the podcasters also sew, and they make project bags, and a lot of them are young women. When I say young women, they're like old enough to be my daughter. That's young to me. But anyway, it's encouraging to see so many people taking up the art of sewing again. I mean, I remember when I was a kid, my mother did a lot of sewing, and then you didn't see it that much. And a lot of fabric stores, you used to find fabric stores all over the place. Now they're hard to find unless it's just Joann's or a little section in Walmart or something like that. So it's exciting and encouraging to see some of these young women who are sewing. And ones I specifically think about that I like to watch are Inside Number 23, of course, the Yarngasm podcast. I like seeing the yarn that she dyes as well. And Stitched in Sweden is another one. And there's numerous that I watch, but those are the three that really kind of stand out. Oh, and Upon a Corgi podcast. She also does some sewing. So, yeah, it's interesting, and they're sewing so much better than mine. So I should take some lessons from my mother. My mother actually has a Bernina sewing machine and used to teach classes and things, and maybe I should just give her the dress and let her sew it for me. So anyway, yeah, maybe I need to make an appointment to go talk with my mom and have her help me with the sewing. So on with that, we are going to go. I'm going to talk about vacation, which sounds like a kind of crazy thing maybe, but we are getting into vacation season, and I love planning for our vacation every year. And we like to go, well, I like to go up to New England. I think it's just really pretty, and I like the temperatures up there. Probably not in the wintertime, but when we go up there, I like it. But there's also a lot of yarn shops, and we are going to Connecticut and Rhode Island this year. So if you live in those states or if you've been to yarn shops in those states, please leave me a comment below and let me know where you went and some recommendations if you've got them. I thought I would share with you how I come up with yarn shops to visit on my vacation, because I like to get yarn that I guess you would call souvenir yarn. I like to buy stuff that is local to the area, where it's either a local dyer or it is produced locally. Things I can't get just like any place. So there are four different websites that you can go to check out yarn shops that are in a given state. And so I thought I'd tell you about that first. There is one called Sweater Babe. And if you haven't checked out that website, it's like a mini Ravelry in a lot of ways. They have patterns on there. They have a monthly newsletter that's free, but they also have a yarn shop registry that you can look for, and you just type in the area you're going to or the state you're going to, and it will tell you all of the yarn shops that are listed in there. And all of these yarn shops together, I looked at four of them because they don't all have the same yarn shops. And I know that some of these yarn shops that I've got listed maybe don't even exist, because I don't know how old these registries are. So as a result, I do go to four of them and compare notes. So the first one is Sweater Babe. The second one is The Daily Knitter. And then another one is called Knit Map. And there is, of course, Ravelry. Now, if you look on Ravelry, I've got fluff from the yarn in my eye. If you go into Ravelry, it doesn't jump out at you where this yarn shop registry is. You have to click on from the home page after you've logged in. If you look up at the top where it says yarn, click on yarn, and about halfway down the page on the left, you will see the yarn registry. And then you type in the city and the state, or if you don't know specifically what city you're looking at, just put the state in the second blank that it gives you. And a certain miles that you're willing to drive within that radius, and it'll pop up with yarn shops as well. So I want to show you what I've got, and then I'll explain something. This is Connecticut. Two pages. The yarn shop is listed here, and then the town it's in. I listed them alphabetically, so when I go to plan our trip, it's a little easier to find them. I've got 1¾ pages of yarn shops. That's for Connecticut. Here's the yarn shops for Rhode Island. Yes, there's a lot of them. There's a reason that there is a lot of them. There are a lot of mills in those areas. Back in the 1718 and even up into the 1900s, there, especially towards the Rhode Island, Massachusetts area, in the Blackstone River Valley, there were a lot of mills. If you've heard of Lowell, Massachusetts, where there were the Lowell Mills. There's a Christian fiction writer named Tracy Peterson who actually wrote a whole series about girls that worked in the Lowell Mills. But that was where they processed the thread and the yarn into fabric. It was up in Lowell, and Lowell is like on the border of New Hampshire and Massachusetts. And then if you go all the way down into Pawtucket, Rhode Island, that area had Slater Mill, which was one of the first factories in the country that had a water-driven mill, and it was they processed the actual yarn itself, the yarn and the thread that was used for fabric. So because of that, there's a lot of mills in the area, and I think that's maybe why there are so many yarn shops. Just a guess, but I think. But, you know, all of these yarn shops, I'd love to visit every single one of them, but my checkbook would be like way overdrawn if I did that, and I'd be spending all of my children's inheritance and probably my grandchildren's inheritance if I did that. You know, it was funny when I was a kid, talking about inheritance. My dad had this running joke. Every time my brother and I did something, you know, ornery when we were teenagers, he'd say he was going to take us out of his will. So it became a running joke with all of us. So when he turned 50 years ago, now my dad is 78 now. So when he turned 50, as he was leaving his 50th birthday party, my brother and I had erected tombstones all the way out the driveway that made crazy remarks about being 50 years old and over the hill. And the last tombstone said, "Are we still in your will?" Just as a joke. So my father found a few years later found a keychain for me that said my inheritance, and it had a penny stuck in it. So then the penny fell out. So he told me, "Oh well, you lost your inheritance." So that part's been a running joke with our family for years. Anyway, on with my vacation planning. What I will do with this, once I have our route nailed down that we're going to take on our trip, then I will eliminate a lot of these yarn shops that are out of the way. Because with this many to choose from, I'm not going to go off the beaten path to go find them. I've got plenty here that are going to be at least close by. So I'm going to go through and eliminate that. And then I go through looking for websites. Before I go spend time driving to a yarn shop, I like to make sure that it, number one, still exists. Number two, I like to know the hours they're going to be open. And I like to see either a website or a Facebook page because I want to see the yarn, what kind of yarn they tend to carry, and whether it's a decent sized shop. I don't want to go a few miles out of the way only to find out that it's a corner of a hardware store and there's a couple shelves of yarn, you know, or that it's just acrylic stuff that I could get, you know, at any store. So I do like to check, and I narrow it down. I keep narrowing it down until I find the ones that fit what I'm looking for. And I'll pick like a handful out of that. I probably will be under 10 that I will actually choose to look at. But that's how I go about doing it. And so, like I said, I look for websites, I look for Facebook pages because I want to see before I go there what I'm getting into. Two that I know I will be hitting will be Must Love Yarn in East Greenwich, Rhode Island. There last year, and if you watch the podcast, The Yarn Shop Girls, which they're very entertaining. It's three ladies, two own the shop, and one is works at the shop. And they're a lot of fun to watch. They do a lot of projects, and they even share projects that some of their customers have made. So you get to see a lot of finished objects usually. They also introduce new yarns that they have in the store, and they're just a lot of fun. And they're one of my subscribers, and I think I've subscribed to them since close to the beginning when they started podcasting as well. So last year, I actually did go there and made a grand entrance. I about tipped over their mannequin when I walked in. I'm memorable for, you know, doing things like that. So, yeah, that's one place I'm definitely going to check out. And if nothing else, just to say hi because we had a good time. Plus, they've moved to another store since last year. Last year, they were in a smaller shop, and now they moved next door. And so, of course, I need to check it out. You know, maybe I won't knock their mannequin over this time. So, yeah, I got to check them out. And another one I definitely want to go to is Peter Patch's Yarns. It is outside of Providence. I believe it's Central Falls or Cranston. It's a warehouse. It's kind of on, it's out in the middle. It's in a town, but it's not like on a main road. It's kind of off of an alley. You had to really look for it. But you go up on the second floor of this warehouse, and there are like 4 by 4 foot bins just lined up with cones of yarn in it. And it's like one whole section is nothing but wool, one whole section is nothing but cotton. You know, he does have acrylics in skeins that are like 75 cents a piece. When I was there last year, that's what they were. And the cones of yarn, you had to buy, I think it was 2 pounds, but it was only $8 for wool yarn for 2 pounds. I mean, 2 pounds of yarn goes a very long ways. I've probably got enough yarn to knit sweaters for myself, my husband, and most of my grandchildren. So I'm going to hit there again too, because yeah, who can't, you know, love a good sale like that? So I've got to check that one out. Other things that I wanted to share with everybody, we have some cowl updates. I have a knit along running with the pattern I designed called Banner Unfurled, and I've made some changes in the cowl for a couple of reasons. Number one, nobody's put a finished project in there yet. The other being that I had contacted the Three Sisters Knit. That's another podcast. If you don't watch, check them out. It's two sisters, Margaret and Sheila, and I had sent them a free pattern and just offered to give a discount to any of their viewers that would like to purchase the pattern. They decided to do a cowl with the pattern. So they have a knit along running over on their channel. So one of the other reasons I'm extending it is that so our cowls will overlap. So if you want to enter my knit along as well as their knit along, you would be able to, and vice versa. If that some of their viewers want to enter mine, they would have that opportunity. So I'm extending it until July 30th. And then the following podcast, I would announce the winners. And to enter, all you have to do is knit the pattern in any colors you want and put it on my Ravelry group. It's Katrina's Creations, all one word, and post a picture of it and tell me what yarn you used when you made it. So that's all you have to do. And I had showed you, I believe it was last week or the week before, that I want to do one for myself in purples because, you know, I like purple. Even though I'm wearing blue today, I like purple. So, yeah, I haven't started it yet because I was trying to figure out what beads to put with it. And then I remembered that I had a purple jade necklace that I made years ago, and then it broke. So I need to track down all of the loose beads that are rolling around in my little container. And I think that's going to be what's going to go on that shawl. So that being said, I've got two other ones that I want to make, and I will show you what they are. The first one is going to be for my mother for Christmas. I always make my mom a shawl for Christmas, and I make my daughter and my daughter-in-law a shawl or a scarf or something as well. So this is the one I'm going to make for my mom. It's looking kind of orange in the light. I don't know if I can block the light and you can see it a little bit better. Nope, it's not going to help it a whole lot. It's actually a definite red. It is not this orangey kind of looking color. I was hoping it would show up. Nope, it's not going to. I thought if I blocked the light, you'd be able to see the color better, but it's not happening. Anyway, it is definite reds, and it has like a chocolate brown and a gold in it. And so I think I'm going to use this, and I'm going to get the chocolate brown and maybe the tan to put with this. I thought about putting a red with this, but I'm afraid that's going to be a little overkill on the red. So I think if I do two shades of the brown that's in here, it's kind of, like I said, one's kind of a dark chocolate and one's kind of a milk chocolate color. So I think I'm going to get browns in those colors to accent it. And I'm not sure what color buttons or beads I'm going to put on it yet. I have to look around. So that's what I'm doing for my mom. I'm also making one for my daughter-in-law. So Renee, close your eyes for a minute. I will not be able to say the color. She told me she likes blue. So I'll show you what I've got, but I can't say the colors out loud. So this is the variegated. And that is showing up pretty true to color. So it's being combined with this and with this gray. Oh, and I just said one of the colors. Oh, well. That's what they are going to look like together. So I think that'll go well. So that's what I'm doing for my daughter-in-law. Now I have, oh, and I want to show you the prizes. Almost forgot the important thing. The prizes. Primrose Yarn in Blueberry Jazz. Primrose Yarn has been talked about a lot. It is a local dire to where I live. She's about 20 miles away. But she has been talked about on the knitting expat. Mina Phillip has been knitting with some of this and working with her on some patterns and designs. And I think Kristen with Yarngasm and Vullenvine Yarns, I think she's also been talking with her. And I think she was doing something with her yarn as well. So, yeah, I've heard Primrose Yarn mentioned by quite a few podcasters lately. So this is the one prize. Well, I mean, it's all part of one prize here. Then you get a project bag. It's a drawstring project bag. And then there's a little clip here that has a progress keeper and some stitch markers. Okay. And something else I'm adding is the first person to post on my Ravelry group with a finished project will receive a set of stitch markers. So, you know, be the first one and you will get some. They're like little charms. They have like little skeins of yarn and little crowns that say like knitting princess or knitting diva. And there's a set of six. So yeah, if you were the first one to post on my Ravelry group, you will be the grand winner of the stitch markers. And then I will do a little acquisitions today. Oh, and the prize that's being offered on Three Sisters Knit is also a skein of yarn. I forget who the yarn is by, but a skein of yarn as well as a project bag. So some decent prizes there. So let me show you what I did on my acquisitions this week. Aside from the two needles I already showed you, I went a little crazy. I've got a set. These I got off of eBay for under $5. There's a set of 11 needles here. Now, I talked about some cheap Chinese needles that I bought on eBay several years ago. They are the pair I am doing my Find Your Fade with. Here they are right there. I love these needles. They're cheap. They have a smooth connection. I use them constantly. They have not worn out. You know, for cheap needles, I have been very, very happy with them. And if you're looking at something that's not going to cost you a whole lot, but be a decent quality, I've been really happy with them. These are the same thing. They're just a different label. These say they are, it's Rue Boyan. Let's see if I can get that close enough. There you go. They came as a set of 11, and I measured them. This one says it is a size 6. I put it in my needle gauge, and I came out with it being a US size 8. And the smallest one they say is a size 16. Let me find it here. Here it is. They say it's a size 16. I measured it, and it was slightly smaller than a size 0. So I'm thinking it's like a 00. I think the sizing they have listed is UK sizing. It seems to be comparable. So I think that the sizes that are listed on this are UK sized. The reason I bought a second set is because I enjoy the first set so much that a lot of times, especially with the common size needles, if I'm knitting with more than one project at a time, you know, I need another set of needles because I don't want to take something off that I'm knitting with. So that's why I bought it, and for under $5, I can't go too far wrong. So that was my one purchase. And then I had a Joann's coupon, and we happened to stop, like my husband went into a grocery store right next door to Joann's. So of course I had to go use my 40% off coupon. So I was folding my dish towels earlier this week and they were feeling kind of disgusting. So I bought some, just the plain old sugar and cream. This is a super size. Get a couple of dishcloths out of. Nothing overly exciting. I do like the colors though. They kind of look summery. And my house is done in this color, in yellows and blues, except for this room, which happens to be green. But everything else is yellow and blue. So that was my acquisitions. Now I'm going to tell you about the book that I, the book recommendation for this week. And it's kind of near and dear to my heart. And you'll understand why when I start talking about it. If you've followed me for any length of time, you know that I work for a library and I am on a bookmobile. So the series that I picked this week is about a lady who's on a bookmobile. Yes, there actually is a cozy mystery series about bookmobiles. So I thought I would tell you, let me show you about the series first. It's written by a lady named Lori Cass. There's 5 books in the series to date. I don't have a copy of the first one, but the first one was called Lending a Paw. This is the second one, Tailing a Tabby. This one's the third one, which is Borrowed Crime. And then there is Pounced on Murder and Cat with a Clue. So, and it's about a lady named Minnie who comes to work at a library and decides that they need a bookmobile. She makes friends with somebody who is rich, and that person donates the money for the bookmobile. We can all dream. But anyway, the library director in the book is not real crazy about the bookmobile, but he decides to let her run with the idea anyway. And along the line, she acquires a cat that travels with her in the bookmobile, and she solves mysteries. Now, the thing that's a little different with this series is the bookmobile service is very different from what our bookmobile service is. So I thought I would take this opportunity to tell you a little bit about bookmobiles and about mine in particular. Unlike the book series, where she only goes out a couple times a week to rural areas and sees a few people here and there, our bookmobile has been, I believe, the first bookmobile in our county started in like 1957. And we're on our 4th or 5th vehicle at this point. And we actually are on the road 5 days a week, Monday through Friday. We see in a 1 month period, we see about 900 people, give or take. But it's close. Sometimes it's a little less, sometimes it's a little more. But on average, during the school year, we see around 900 people. We're on a 3-week rotation, the same as when you go to a regular library and you check your books out and you get them for usually 3 weeks. It's the same with our bookmobile. We're on a 3-week schedule. And in that 3-week period, because we're out on the road 5 days a week, we have 15 separate trips. Each trip has 5 to 6 stops on average. So at the current time, I think we are up to like 69 or 79 stops. We go to daycares in the morning, you know, larger daycares, and then we go to private schools. We go to some public schools where there's children that have disabilities that might, where they need to have a little help getting on board. Our vehicle is equipped that someone can get on board if they would like to. And so we do that. We see seniors in the afternoon. And we go to after schools. So, we see like from real little to older people. So it's a good age range that we see. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history of bookmobiles before I show you a slide presentation that's going to show you the inside of the vehicle that I'm on. So I was really surprised when I started doing a study about the bookmobiles. To discover that there were 2 book wagons in England. That's the earliest ones. They've got drawings of them, and they were in 1858 and 1859. There were 2 separate ones in the United Kingdom that were functioning. But as for the U.S., I was really, really shocked to find out that the very first one was in the state that I work in. The very first bookmobile came about in 1903. It actually, let me backtrack a little bit. Back in 1901, Washington County, Maryland, which is about 2 counties away from where I work. I live in Pennsylvania. I work in Maryland. Washington County is, it's a rural county. It's very mountainous. The biggest town there is Hagerstown. If you look at a map of Maryland and you see where it starts to get narrow, Washington County is right where it starts to narrow. It's right in that section. So, this little county of Washington County was the second county in the nation to form a countywide library system. That surprised me. But then, even more so, in 1903, there was a woman named Mary Titcomb who came from New England. She became the librarian for the county. And she realized that with the rural mountainous area, there were a lot of people who did not have access to books and to a library. So she decided that they needed to come up with some kind of library service for these people. So she came up with the idea of a wagon. It was kind of like a box-shaped wagon. Like if you look at old pictures, you'll see like milk wagons or dairy wagons. People, would get their ice delivery or an ice delivery wagon, kind of box-shaped. That's what the wagon looked like. It was drawn by two horses, and they wanted it to look dignified, so they painted the whole thing black. The man who was driving the horses, I guess you call it driving, I'm not sure what you would say, but anyway, he was holding the reins to the horses and dispensing the books, was actually the library janitor. His name was Joshua Thomas, and they ran into one problem with having the library look dignified. The library cart looking dignified was that people kept mistaking them for the undertaker and a hearse. So they decided that they needed to brighten it up a little bit. And I think they put some gilding or some red, they painted the wheels red or something like that. If you want to see pictures of the very first bookmobiles, you can, I will put a link in the description box below. Or if you go to my Pinterest page, which is Katrina Knits, if you go there, I have a board on bookmobiles, and there's all different kinds of pictures of bookmobiles, including some bookmobile humor that was like in the Far Side and things like that. But anyway, this bookmobile, the very first one in the US, ran from 1905 until 1910, when unfortunately it was hit by a train outside of Hagerstown in a little area called St. James. And it said it completely demolished the wagon. Hopefully, the man and the horses, it didn't say whether they were hurt or not. They then replaced that 2 years later in 1912 with a motorized vehicle. I guess it would have been like a Model A or a Model T, something like that. That's also in that picture, that link that I told you about. So that is kind of where the history of bookmobiles have gone, and they've just continued to grow since then. There were a lot of them that were produced in the 1920s and all the way up to current day. They've come a long ways. A lot of the original bookmobiles you couldn't go into. The books were actually along the outsides of the vehicle, like on shelves that faced on the outside, and they were covered by canvas or by like a cabinet that would close to protect them from the elements. So you didn't actually go on board, unlike the ones we have today where people actually get inside them. So I also have found out that there are other mobile libraries throughout the country, or throughout the world actually, that aren't necessarily even carts or wagons or anything. Some countries use camels that they use like backpacks, and they carry the books in backpacks on camels, on donkeys, on elephants. Glad I don't have to drive that. And Norway actually has a library boat that travels to a lot of the remote coastal communities in Norway, and people can come onto the boat and check out books. So I thought that was cool too. So I also found out that there was a Smithsonian article, Smithsonian Magazine put out an article in February 2011 about a particular bookmobile that a man named Tom Corwin found. It was a used one. He restored it. He contacted some children's authors who donated books that they had written, and then he traveled across the United States and gave away some of these books. And I'll put the link to the article below again in the description bar. I tried to find a reference to this because apparently there was a documentary made about this called Behind the Wheel of a Bookmobile. I could not find any reference. Whether the documentary was ever made, I don't know. There was talk of it, but I couldn't find any links to it at all. So now on to my bookmobile. I've already told you about how many people we see at a time, but I thought I would explain ahead of time some of the slides you're going to see. The very first slide, there's a total of 9. The very first one you're going to see is the outside of the vehicle. We are parked in a parking lot. Most bookmobiles do not have restroom facilities. So when we stop for lunch or whatever, we have to park someplace where we really fit. So we tend to find parking lots that are big. And it's interesting how curious people are. Rather than just knock on the door and want to come in and see, they drive by us while we're parked in parking lots. But they drive by us sometimes very close. I looked up one time, I was eating lunch, and a car went zooming by. He was maybe less than a foot away from us when he went zipping through. So you always have to look before you open up the window because there might be somebody coming through in the parking lot. But the dimensions of our bookmobile, we are 30 feet long, 11 and a half feet tall, and 8.5 feet wide. And we weigh around 9 tons. You may say, why do you need to know all those? We need to know where we fit and where we don't, because there's certain things we can't go under or over, and there's certain roads we don't fit on either. So we always have to know that. We are actually the largest commercial vehicle you can have for our state, the largest commercial vehicle without a CDL. So there are 2 people on board all the time, and that is so that you've got the best visibility you can have, so that we're both watching and looking for other people. We've never had an accident. We have an excellent driver. Thank you, Cindy. And she is our full-time person. And then there's myself, and there's another lady that fills in. I work part-time. She works the other days that I don't. And the 3 of us all work together. And let's see, the next slide that you're going to see is of the desk where I work. We have two laptops on board, and we have a Wi-Fi connection. So we can actually do on board anything that they can do in a branch. We just don't have the same space. So it makes it interesting. We don't carry everything we own on the bookmobile because there's just, you are limited. So we only carry the seasonal and the holiday things that apply to that particular time. So we do have an office where we park and where we keep our overflow items. And for each of the 15 trips that we go on, we have holds for those different people that we're going to see. And a hold is like a reserve, something that somebody wants that's specific. And if it's like a daycare center, they might tell us, oh, we want something on zoo. So we'll have a whole bunch of books on zoo. So the second slide that you'll see my desk, and sitting up to the side are these stacks of books. Those are holds. But what you don't see in the picture is sitting underneath my desk is an entire big bag full of holds that just wouldn't fit on the shelf. So one of the other pictures that you will see is the back of the vehicle, which is where we check in items that are getting returned. And in the picture, you'll see stacks. I think there's 3 or 4 stacks of books that are lined up there. That's only about half of what was returned at that particular stop. Some of our stops are smaller, but a lot of our stops are bigger, and some of our centers will actually check in 150 or more items and check out the same number. So what you see stacked over there is actually after I put away about half of them. The last 2 slides in the picture, you will see bags sitting on the floor. At the end of the day, we carry in whatever was returned to us that doesn't belong directly to the bookmobile. It might be things that belong to the main system, or it might be books that even belong to other counties within our state. So those are carried in. On average, we carry about 3 big canvas bags out of materials every day and put them on board the vehicle. And we usually carry in about those 3 same bags stuffed full in the afternoon. On this particular day, we had 5 bags and a box full of books to carry in. So we had quite a load that particular day. When I did do the shots for this, this was one of our busier trips that we go on. So that being said, I'm going to put the slide presentation on and I'm going to say goodbye now. And I will see you again next week. Thanks again for stopping by. Click the subscribe button if you enjoyed it, or if you'd like to be a viewer, regular viewer, and get notifications of when I put up my podcast. Give me a thumbs up if you liked it, and I'll see you again next week. Stay tuned for the video. Thanks.
The gas on the bus goes glug, glug, glug.